super involved with my sports. My main sport was football when I was younger, and he was athletic when he was younger, but not a football player, so he admittedly did not know a whole lot about the game. He played rugby, and what else did he do? Motocross, rugby, a little bit of track and field. So I got some good genes from him, I think, but I didn't get as much sporting advice. Some things stuck with me, though. My dad did not try to give me advice on football, because like I said, he didn't really know the game, but a few things he always told me. One, always know the rules. Know the rules of the game. You know, the rules can work for you or against you, but you must know the rules. I mean, you can't maximize yourself as an athlete and maximize yourself in the game if you don't know the rules of the game. So that was something I always paid attention to. Another one came from both my father and from Mr. Pledger, who is not in here. I don't see him. He's hiding back there. He's always hiding. So this one came from my father and Mr. Pledger, and it was never argue with the referee. So I'm not sure why my dad picked that one in particular, but it stuck with me. With Mr. Pledger, it was in water polo, which is also a very tough, physical, grueling sport, and in many ways it set me up well for mountain biking, the fact that I played water polo here. And you know, the referees have a big influence on the game of water polo, just like they do in many sports, like football and some other sports. They can have an influence, and they can get things right, they can get things wrong, but you know, arguing is not going to change their mind. Once they've made the call, they've made the call. And Mr. Pledger was really big on that. Like, do not argue, do not talk back, do not even look at the referee the wrong way, accept the call and move on. So these are important lessons to me that kind of have nothing to do with the game itself, but they have something to do with the culture of sports and you know, the culture or the traits and the nature of a person. Yeah.
Seems to me a big part of your success, I think clearly, was the rally budgie that you had at a young age. I'm wondering what came next. Was it perhaps the grifter, or what was your next bike, or the rally chopper perhaps? And those of us who grew up at that time, we all had our favourites.
I think it was either boxer or boxer.
Oh yeah, there was a rally boxer, yeah.
That was the next one.
Okay.
I did get a mountain bike. I was probably maybe 13 years old when I got like a mountain bike style, but you remember the budget.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Who was your inspiration?
So my inspiration when I first started mountain biking, one of them was my father. You know, he was racing, he was well into his 40s at the time. He had not been an athlete all the way through. He had was an athlete when he was younger, and then he kind of got out of shape when he was having kids through his 20s and 30s. And then he decided he was going to get back into shape in his early to mid 40s, about the age that I am now. And you know, mountain biking was good for him. He discovered mountain biking, got into great shape in his 40s. So that was inspirational. On the racing side, there were a couple of guys that I appreciated because they raced in different, they had multiple talents. They weren't just a one-trick pony. So in mountain biking, there was a guy called John Tomac. I don't know if there's anyone that would know who he is, but he was an American mountain biker that excelled in both cross-country, which is one of these endurance things, and also downhill racing, which is a bit more kind of gung-ho, crazy, top of the mountain, down to the bottom. And usually it was a totally different kind of athlete and person that would excel in downhill from cross country, and this guy could do both. So that impressed me, and I looked up to him. And then there was also a racer, a Swiss guy called Thomas Frischknecht, who was at the time probably the best cross country racer in the world. And I'm always looking for, you know, for me it needs to be more than just sports, it's always needs to be something else. And this guy, Thomas Frischknecht, was very well educated. You know, he'd been to school and university in Switzerland. He was a smart guy. He was a family guy. He already had kids, and he was still racing at the highest level. So he was just a very well-rounded individual that could do all these things and still win world championship races. Did I beat Lance Armstrong? I believe I beat him once. I think I raced him two or three times, and one of the times I did race him. It usually wasn't the biggest kind of world championship type race. It would be a smaller race when he was done his road season and you know, he was able to jump into a mountain bike race. But I think I did beat him one time. Yeah.
We're probably getting close to the end now.
Okay, final question. Our photographer. Yes.
I'm an old boy from this school. When I was at school, I was ranked 6th in the UK at decathlon. I'm 55 now. Do you have the same problems as I do, is thinking that you can still do it and that you'll challenge anyone who's under 17 to have a go if they think they're hard enough? You're a bit younger than me, so I don't know.
I definitely always do still think I can do it. I'm playing football again now, so I picked up playing football again about 3 or 4 years ago. I was playing with some of the younger guys at first, and completely just like that, like, this is no problem, I can still do it, I can still run fast. You know, but a couple times I found out it wasn't quite there like it used to be, and, you know, you go into a tackle one time, and I just regular tackle like I've done 1,000 times before, kick the ball away, maybe caught the guy's foot a little bit on the follow through and broke my toe. Like, how did that happen? I shouldn't have broken my toe right there. I think that's age coming into it a little bit. And then, yeah, now and again, I'm trying to do things that, in my mind, I see them one way, and then it actually works out a little bit differently with age. But I definitely want to keep going. I'm keeping going for my kids, and, you know, stay active and do things with them as they get more into, you know, whatever it is they're going to get into, and I don't know what that is, but I want to be there and be active and do that with them.
I think so. Thank you very much.
A wonderful talk. My own bike when I was young had a basket on the front. but it is inspiring to hear from such an athlete and messages for us all. I'd like to call upon Aaron Davis to give a formal vote of thanks.
I'd just like to say thank you to Chris for coming back to the call. To share his story with us, and to me as an elite sportsman myself, it's such an inspiration for you to be here. So I would just like you to join me in saying thanks to Chris again.
I'd like to thank again for the presentation of the topic. It clearly inspired to know how much I enjoy putting such memorabilia on the walls, and that inspires us in the dining room every day. That will fit very nicely. In studying the school records, as you know, I always like to look at the old reports of people before I invite them back. Regrettably, there wasn't anything worth sharing with you this evening. This man is as he seems, nearly perfect. However, I did notice an omission. I know the sports department here at Bolton School has exacting and high standards, but I find it incredible that Chris Eatough left the school only having been awarded half colours. I would ask you, what do you have to do? So I would like to right that wrong this evening and present Chris with full colours. Join us down in the League of Hume 3-4 for refreshments and perhaps further conversation. And thank you very much for joining us this evening and asking such interesting questions which have informed us all. Thank you.